All right. It's great to be living my life right now. So we're just going to spread some of that love around. Had a great opportunity today that I took. A really, really, really good friend of mine that has helped me out in a selfless way in just over the years, and just a tremendous amount of help he's given me. It's just amazing, real blessing. Well, it was his birthday, and we were in a work group, and we all decided to go get some lunch. So we're in line, and finally it's just me and him in line. Everybody was paying for their own lunch. I was wondering, well, who's going to pay for his lunch? And it was just the two of us left. I said, wow, you know, I'm thinking, yeah, I'm not going to let him buy his own lunch on his birthday. That's crazy. But I am not a man of means. And so I had like $46 in my wallet. That's all the money I have in the world. And I've been carrying that around for almost like a month or so, just because it makes me feel good to have some money in my wallet. And I said, well, you know, I'm buying him lunch. I don't care if it takes all the money I have in the world. I'm buying him lunch on his birthday. So, of course, he declined. Said, no. But I insisted. I insisted. And I was able to do it, which was really cool. And you know, when you don't have money, it's a real commitment when you do something like that. I didn't want to even go to the restaurant. I said, oh my gosh, I can't afford it. But I said, I've got to, because it's, you know, it's his birthday. I can't just, you know, beg off. Got to do it. So, but what a blessing. I was able to do something for him. You know, it's just tremendous. It's a good thing I had some money to do it. And you know, he's the type. If you had a business, he should be your first hire. Okay, that's how good he is. Any company, I would advise him, hire this guy as your first hire. Okay, you cannot go wrong. You just can't go wrong. He's that good. You know, he'll give you the shirt off his back, and work all day. And then say, forget it, you know. Nah, don't worry about it. I was like, what? Yeah, amazing guy. So, what a blessing. And, you know, and then afterwards he thanked me. He appreciated it. He appreciated somebody stepped up to the plate and said, hey, come on. Don't let somebody buy their own lunch on their birthday. So there you go. That was one little thing. This was after a night. I went to bed at like 10:30 at night, early, right? Too early, apparently, because I woke up at 11:45 p.m. I said, oh, is it morning yet? I said, you know, like an hour's gone by. Uh-oh. And then from then on, I couldn't really sleep, so I sort of stayed awake all night long. A little bit on and off, I dozed. And so I started just working on all this spiritual clarity. That's all. What else did I do? I have a whole night tonight to do it. Isn't that great? And I had a great experience. Really great experience. It's a little difficult to explain, actually. But I believe it was the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. And what it was just total blackness. Hard to explain. I was quite surprised. I said, how can it be so beautiful? Of course, the blackness is being seen in intrinsic spaciousness. So intrinsic spaciousness is not darkened out by the blackness. So your awareness is still bright. Okay, not in terms of light bright, but bright in terms of being fully aware of what you're experiencing. So I realized that seeing blackness doesn't darken your awareness, actually, at all. And in fact, in seeing that, all my thoughts were gone. There's no contrast there. There's nothing to evaluate in this total, pure, beautiful blackness. Then I realized that the Kali, from India, the Kali, her jet blackness, it is a symbol, I believe, for this blackness. It's a very potent Kali is a very potent spiritual symbol. It's used in India. I've never really understood it so well, but it's maybe I'm starting to experience some of that with the symbology of it. So that I was just an extraordinary experience, and I really had to work for it. Really been pressed in various ways, and so I said, I have to have something here. And so this is what happens. Desperation is your friend. Trouble is your friend. This is what I found. I usually am pushed by desperation. Otherwise I wouldn't do it. So my whole life has been one long saga of desperation, actually. But it makes me dig in and say, oh man, I've got to get something really, I really have to shift my expectations here. I just have to. I don't have any choice, and I'll stay up all night. I'll work at it for 12 hours. Whatever it takes, I have to get this shift in expectations. Not like it's an option. It's like a must. It's do or die. So yeah, it's very difficult, tough, you might say, to be faced with continual desperation. But it also is a tremendous motivator. And so far, I'm still here. That burrito, though, killed my weight. I mean, that's the burrito itself. I use it as a barbell, you know. Should have taken it home, just done curls with it or something. It's ridiculous, the burritos that they give you here. Come on. What are we? What are we? We weigh 250 pounds? I mean, come on, I'm on a diet. I don't. Maybe they should have diet burritos. At least I had a diet drink. I had something with stevia in it, which is a lemonade. They mask the stevia really nicely. There's this vitamin water, and this with lemonade, just it's vitamin water one, with like one calorie or something. They use stevia, and it's really good. And so I didn't get any calories from the drink, which was nice. But I can feel that burrito. It's like, what did I do to myself? Tortured myself. Now, I'm having all these clarifications about culture and seeing how wise religion really is. It's really quite an experience. Most people think, modern people think religion is kind of stupid and a bunch of archaic laws and all this kind of stuff. And I didn't know. I just said, you know, I just keep having these spiritual experiences and breakthroughs. And looking at them, I realized, hey, wait a minute. What is it that led to this and well, all these good habits and all these leverage and faith and all? And I said, wait, that's what religion provides. And so more and more and more, as I wise up, really, I'm seeing the wisdom of religions, and they've been put together by a tremendous grace of God, actually. And it's extraordinary that, first, like the issues, social issues. I really said, well, I don't know. I really don't know. I always was sort of on the fence, like abortion. I said, I don't know what God wants about, you know, what is really helpful. Should we have abortion or not? And with the experiences that I'm having, I'm able to see, culturally, from a standpoint of how do we get helped to have the experiences that I'm having, and I can recognize that there's a certain cultural layout and that is very, very important. It makes it so much easier, makes what is almost prohibitively difficult accessible to a lot of us. Accessible. Now, my path has been prohibitively difficult. I wouldn't advise anybody to take the path of desperation like I have. I want it to be easier because most people won't do that. They won't do that. I got a lot of help, but it was still, it's still just been, you know, ridiculous. And I can tell most people are not they stalled out. They stalled out. So it needs to be, there needs to be more support, cultural support for everyone. So this is called Bodhisattva. This attitude is, I'm trending towards the Bodhisattva path. And so that's a little different than most in the world, I notice. Most of the world are trying to, you know, get enlightened, drop their thoughts and be enlightened or whatever. But for me, I've always been interested in how do you help others, and on a big scale, in the big picture, not just this generation, but, you know, hundreds of generations to come, and worlds to come, and, you know, rebirths to come. And that all, that's what I've always been interested in. How do you set up a world that's beneficial, I mean, beneficial, a cultural situation that supports what needs to be done? That, I find that very, very important. So, like in Buddhism, there's Theravada and Mahayana Buddhism. Theravadins say that, you know, your own liberation, that's it. You know, you're enlightened and you're done. Whereas in Mahayana Buddhism and Tibetan Buddhism, most definitely, the Bodhisattva ideal is that you're not done until everyone's done. So this is just a sort of a way of referring that your focus is on teaching and how to help everyone else. And so the training is different. You have to be willing to really, really, really be keenly interested in this. And so I am. I've always have been. So if I look at something, I'm looking at, well, you know, but how do you implement this? And like this advice, everyone gives this advice on Facebook, but nobody posts about practicing at all. And I'm saying, look, I mean, this is, yeah, drop your thoughts. Even like A Course in Miracles, Jesus says, you know, relax your thought, relax your mind, release your thoughts and let them go. Well, guess what? Nobody's going to do that except the rare, rare anomaly. And they themselves are only going to do that through right practice, actually. Without that right, you can't just say the words and expect it to happen. Because it doesn't. Other than in some rare anomalies. So why? You know, why? And there's reasons for that. This world has really been sabotaged, you might say. Away from faith. Christians, for instance, are supposed to talk about their faith publicly, and that is just not happening. I only know one person that does that. He talks right even in his workplace to me, and I encourage him to. Tell me the gospel for today. What's the gospel today? And he's really happy and says, well, and he's great. I mean, he's great at it. He's a big, big help. You're supposed to share the miracles you experience. You're supposed to share your faith-based success. You know, in other words, say, I had faith in this, and look what happened. That is supposed to be shared openly, publicly, in the classroom, with friends, you know, at lunch, etc., in the workplace. You can't ban that from the workplace. That is crazy. Yeah. So anyway, there's all these things about culture that are working against us right now, really working against us, and I'm aware of it, and most are not aware of this so much. So the Bodhisattva path is one who not only reaches the peace of God, abides in the peace of God, but also is very keenly aware of the skillful means on how to get there, and also very much aware of the overall cultural support system that leads one to actually start having the confidence to start practicing, because practicing will bring success. In the world right now, everyone's terrified of success. Nobody wants to really succeed. They'll talk about it, but they don't really, they're afraid to succeed because they might be, you know, stick out like a, you know, they wouldn't fit in to culture, our culture. So they're kind of stuck at just nice pictures and quotes. So I just, my overall awareness and setup is certainly going on the Bodhisattva path. And getting a culture where, you know, talk is cheap. It's the action, it's the practice that we engage in that's important. There's too much talk in the world and not enough action. Well, speaking of abortion, I'll come back to that. There's a whole lot of reasons why you don't want to legalize abortion, really. A whole lot of reasons. But it's one of the key turning pivot points in culture, actually. Because those who support abortion, there's a whole lot of reasons why they want abortion, actually. Because they want to get away from a faith-based culture. They want that to end, and they think they have a way to be happy with insecurity of trying to fixate hallucination. We're hallucinating the absence of God, and we're trying to fixate that. They think that, and we can't fixate it. But they say, don't worry, we know we can be happy, even with our insecurities. And Dharmic culture says, no, you can't. That's impossible, and that's the truth. You cannot be happy with insecurity. The insecurity is total, because we can stop hallucinating any instant. Every single one of us. So that's a severe insecurity. There's no way we can find happiness with that. Trying to, let's just everybody fornicate freely, right? And if there's all these babies, unwanted babies, just kill them, right? That's really the goal. Their goal is quite amazing. And it's, you know, coming to the surface. It has been for quite some time. You know, it just, do all the sex, all the drugs, all the depraved behavior you want, and that's, they hope that will kill this feeling, this inner feeling of insecurity. You say, well, if you can do anything you want to in this world, then why should you feel insecure? That's their logic of absurdity, actually. So they have a whole agenda and social program designed for that. And when you see that faith does work, and that you can be liberated from your evaluating your progress to fixating hallucination, and you realize that it's not a dangerous, fearful thing to stop hallucinating the absence of God, and it's something we all have to do, we don't have any choice, but we have to do this, then you know very well that this effort to just, you know, almost like a sort of a social anarchy, do whatever you want to do, that's never going to get the job done. It's never going to get the job done. It's going in the opposite direction, actually. So the wise religion is socially conservative. They're rules. It's not anarchy. It's rules, pretty strict rules. There's certain things you just don't do. You don't do. You don't have children out of wedlock, for instance. You don't get divorced. You don't have abortion. You know, you don't commit adultery. You don't lie. You don't steal. You don't cheat. You know, you don't kill anyone. You don't attack anyone. You don't bear false witness. You know, the Ten Commandments, for instance. If those, you live by that. It's very serious. And you don't just do whatever you want to do. You do not. That's Dharmic culture. So there's very, 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 very good reasons for all this. It's super, super, super helpful. The stability that one gets culturally, the stability ends up with people actually practicing, believe it or not. Whereas right now, the insecurity that everyone feels with the way the culture is now, it's so unstable. Nobody feels like they can spend the time practicing. It feels too threatening to them, because what we practice is melting our expectations, and that makes one feel very insecure in the short term. Very insecure indeed. You don't exactly know what to do because your expectations have suddenly changed, and you're not really sure what your new expectations are. So you just have to be committed to non-action. But in this world, when you're told that the way to get rid of insecurity is to constantly be active, being happy, doing something fun, you feel threatened by non-action. It makes you feel very insecure. But if you have faith, it doesn't. Because you have faith, this is going to work to truly liberate me from all this self-evaluation, which causes me to pretend that I'm been born, I'm a body, I'm vulnerable, I'm going to die, you know, all this stuff. It's all totally made up in our minds, totally made up. And this practice is the way to ultimately have the peace of God come upon us. So with imperceptible gentleness, and all of that suffering and regrets, all of that's gone. No insecurity. It's vanished. Insecurity is vanished. Without a trace. Vanished without a trace, like it never was. That goal is reachable for all of us. In fact, we all have to reach it. But it is very reachable when we practice properly. The problem of everybody in the world is they just don't do that. And so then you have to dig into why are they not doing it. It's so simple. It's so easy. And yet they don't do it, and wail and complain and keep on getting sick and aging, dying, spending their time watching television or, you know, movies, just trying to have fun, thinking that that's the answer, having fun. And anything that stands in the way of people having fun is seen as evil in such a society, right? Oh, you know, repressive society. I remember in the 60s, did the baby boomers attack their parents' generation. They just vilified it. They said, you're so conservative and repressed, and you don't want anybody to have fun. And you know, and they just, there was this hatred for it, tremendous hatred. The poor parents like, what's going on with my kids? I don't understand. Well, sex, drug, and rock and roll. The pill, abortion, you know, on and on and on. We can have fun, you know, we can have fun now. Whereas you didn't have a fun life. And they said, well, we're storing up our treasures in heaven, you know. We understand that this disciplined life, you know, leads to humility, which leads to proper prayer, which leads to ultimately getting into what's called the kingdom of heaven, which is really the mental state of the peace of God. So they were trained through, you know, so many generations to look at it that way. So they felt that just trying to have as much fun as you possibly can in life, that's not where it's at all. But the boomers said, no, it's just, you only have one life to live, and let's just, and there's no heaven, no hell. Like, you know, John Lennon, that song Imagine, which was a baby boomer song, they loved it. Imagine there's no heaven, you know, no hell below us, you know, that kind of thing. Imagine that all that stuff your parents told you is a bunch of lies. That's what John Lennon was saying. He was really an anarchist. And as were the Beatles helped lead people away from faith for the most part, right? They really did. You know, hey, everybody, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and live your life to the fullest, have as much fun as you possibly can, and then, you know, you're dust, and so what? Nobody cares then. Which is completely untrue. Completely untrue. Because you will find yourself, once again, having to pretend you're making progress to fixating the mind, and that pretense will take on the imaginary dream-like appearance of a body in a world, suffering, getting sick and dying again. And that goes on and on and on until we give up trying to fixate the mind. Say it's not possible. And we forgive ourselves and ultimately stop our self-evaluation, which we call thinking, our concepts. Thinking concepts is really just self-evaluation or evaluating how are we doing in fixating the mind, defining freedom. How are we doing in defining freedom? That's called, A Course in Miracles calls that the ego. But it's really just self-evaluation. Thinking is self-evaluation. We are evaluating ourselves and asking and trying to prove that we're making progress to defining freedom. And that progress involves death as a very key component. And you have to have a body in order to produce death, don't you? So really, when we believe that we're a body, we're doing so for the purpose so that we can have the body die and then either be cremated or decompose, and believing that proves, that fixates the mind. That defines freedom. It's been able to define and fixate the mind. That's what we believe in. That's why we believe in death. That's why we have death. We're the ones doing death, or imagining death. Death is all being imagined, and as is dissolution, decay, in other words, decay, rot, decay, all that stuff, breaking down, everything. That's all being imagined. In order to believe death is in order to believe that, hey, look at the body, it's now fixated. And we think that the body is the mind. And we identify that the body is the mind, the brain is now fixated. And then to keep it from coming back to life, we have decay take place. It's all being imagined, totally imagined by us. So the boomers, just got it totally, severely wrong. And subsequently, they raised kids who have it even more wrong. But not everybody's that stupid, okay? Some of us say, wait a minute. I wasn't technically a boomer. I was just 1 year after. A boomer's like 45 to 55, basically. And I was 56. So I was super close to the boomers, but not really a boomer. There was a different vibe, and I just watched them and everything they did. And they've been doing it for a long time, right? 50, 60 years now. Even more. I mean, I don't know. If you're born in 45, that's like, so what, 70 years maybe or something. But 45, 55, 65, 75, 85, 95, 105, 115, that's 70, 72 years. Some boomers are 72 years old. So they've been basically commandeering the culture of this planet for 72 years. And so I just watched it all and observed. I said, hey, I think I just can't go along with everything they're saying. It just, something doesn't add up. But they said, we're free. Look how we're flowing. We're free now. We're liberated, having so much fun. Join the fun. Don't be like our parents, those really serious, disciplined, not so much fun, And now, I was like, not so sure about this. So I put some limits on my fun, tried to. It wasn't easy, being that close to the boomers. I mean, they were just like a whirlwind, absolute whirlwind. And they've continued a whirlwind through the ages here, right? The decades, 7 decades plus. Ultimately, I was able to get away from it, and I'm still working to get away from it, because their boomers are running the world right now, and their attitudes are absolutely controlling the world right now. And it's tough. It's really tough to stand up to it. Like Facebook's 99% that kind of attitude, really. I mean, it's just really amazing. And it's all very, very non-dharmic, actually. Very non-dharmic. You can't say you're dharmic if you don't really walk the walk, actually. You have to have the best interests of others at heart, in a wise way. In a wise way. You can't just say, "Oh, I love you," and stuff, and then say, "Yeah, go ahead and do whatever you want to do," and instead, that's not dharmic, actually. Now everyone's, a little different this way and that way, but still, there is a basic. There's a lot of basic parameters. And so if you're what you're doing, ultimately you can see now after 72 years that they've trying to kill faith, trying to kill faith. More and more and more and more and more. They're getting more virulent about that. The younger generation, very virulent about that, not even understanding what faith really is. And so you're just spitting into the wind when you talk, when you try to help with this. But I've done my homework on all of this. So that's the Bodhisattva path. I didn't just say, well, I mean, I really have studied it all and looked into it and gotten hindsight on all of it to an extreme degree. So I'm able to then, say, well, lessons of history. You got to learn the lessons of history so we don't just keep repeating the same old mistakes over and over and over. You have to catch the mistakes. So social conservatism is really very dharmic in a lot of ways. Certainly say no to drugs. No question about it. Drugs are such an incredibly bad influence. You look at the countries where drugs have just overrun the countries, and look what's happened. You see that in Central and South America, Central America, and Mexico, various places. The devastation that it has wrought. How can anybody in their right mind think that drugs are a good thing? I mean, that just is so imbecilic, actually. From a dharmic standpoint, that's totally imbecilic. It's basically just refusing to look at any, the evidence, really. And, I get firsthand reports from people. They just tell me what's really going on, and it's just it's a great destroyer. Drugs make you feel like just do anything you want for sensations right now. There's no deferred gratification. There's no discipline. All the virtues go out the window. It's just ruinous to dharmic culture. Drugs. Dalai Lama said drugs are poison. Means poison to dharmic culture. Absolutely true. And yet nobody seems to even hardly understand that in the slightest bit right now. Culture of aspiration has just turned into a culture of immediate gratification. Right? So I say the Dharma kings want a culture of incentive. They want to incentivize the spiritual path. And that's how I've been helped. You meet a Dharma king and they say, well, yeah. And you realize, hey, wait a minute, I must have been doing something right. What have I been doing right? Well, all this spiritual discipline and practice. And then you say, well, how do I meet them again? Well, more practice, better practice, more advancement. And they let you know that they're there. If you want to help them, that you the contact will grow and continue and get better. This is a massive incentive, massive, massive incentive. So if you modern culture doesn't even believe the Dharma kings exist, so you talk about de-incentivizing ourselves, it's hideous what they're doing. They think that when you die, you're finished. So how can there be these great spiritual teachers incentivizing us? They think that's crazy, So they really are going on such a dangerous path. When you start de-incentivizing everyone to the spiritual path, you are on a ruinous path, actually. Because then, without any incentive, you will just go fall deeper and deeper and deeper into really all sorts of depravity and mental, bad mental states, really, really, really dissociative, psychotic type of states, mental states. A friend of mine told me an experience he had just a couple days ago of this psychotic, and I told him this guy might be a psychopath, actually, that he experienced, and he just said, I mean, just like, there's no reason for it at all. Just completely, you know, freaked him out. Now, you know, could have been the grace of God telling him to do something. That's how I looked at it. I said, that's how I looked at it. But you get a world full of psychotics, and then, you know, sociopaths and psychopaths. You know, it's not a good world that we're headed towards right now. So the way to pull out of that is incentivize the spiritual path. So I came in with tremendous belief in the Dharma Kings. I was born with that. So there's no way that anybody could tell me that they don't exist and the gurus are false. I mean, everybody tried, but it didn't work. I just held my own, in my faith, my central core faith was, they do exist, they are legitimate, they do help us, and they will help me. And that's exactly what happened. But, you know, the world really, really, really tried to get me to disbelieve in that, which would have collapsed the whole incentive plan for me. Would have collapsed it, but it destroyed me. That's how wicked the world is right now. We don't understand what a wicked place this world has become, actually. You can't even talk about this. I talk about it openly, trying to help people, those who do believe, to encourage them to keep believing. I say, Sri Sri Nandamayama, to their devotees, I say, look, she is helping you right now. Believe me, she is. She is completely aware of you right now. She is completely alive and functioning and involving herself in your life and doing all sorts of grace for you. And you can literally meet her, as I have many, many times, and have this tremendous incentive experience. You can also look at her pictures, for instance, and get this feeling, but it was important to know that she is still exactly the same as she's always been. But most people think, well, you know, it doesn't register. Like, what are you talking about? She's dead. Dead. No. There's no such thing as death. We're the ones believing in death, not her. We're the ones trying to prove that we're making progress to fixating the mind, not her. She doesn't need to prove that she's fixating the mind because she's not trying to fixate the mind. She knows the mind cannot be fixated. So there's no death in her at all. You know, we saw a death because that's what we wanted. We saw the body die and we said, well, that's a death. For her, it's not. She'd never identify with the body at all. It's just that she wasn't communicating, using the body to communicate with us anymore. But she can communicate directly with your mind, mind to mind, so to speak. Just one mind communicating with itself, actually, is what it is. The mind just communicates with itself. And awareness is still perfectly there. Everything's perfectly intact. There just isn't a physical body for us. But she could produce one if she wanted to at will, instantly. So the Dharma Kings are like that. And I've spoken up about this my whole life. And because it's really important, because of the meetings I've had, like with Ramana Maharshi, how that changed my life, saved my life. The incentive was so strong that I received from him that I said, you know, I just have to keep on going. I just have to. Because someday I'm going to see him again. I'll have the opportunity to. Benny's blessed me in quite a few ways, actually, and more to come, right? More to come. So it's a super, super incentive to look at it this way, to accept the Dharma Kings into your life. Accept the Dharma Kings into your life. And they will incentivize you. They absolutely will. And this causes you then to really, really work with a great purpose in your life, really work with a great purpose. That's what keeps me going. I say, I want to meet them again, you know, because that is such an experience, such that the world doesn't have anything like it to offer you, actually. You cannot define it, the experience, actually. Because really, they have perfect certainty. And how do you define perfect certainty? What is the certainty about that have perfect certainty that you are free, as is everyone else free? They have perfect certainty in your freedom. And how do you, you can't define freedom, right? So you cannot really define this experience. But it's a treasure. It's a great, great treasure. And then you want more of that treasure. So the battle really is the world's trying to shut down incentive. And they say, well, you know, Jesus was some social activist rabbi. And you know, he died, he's gone. But he said some nice stuff about treat people nice and things like that. So what they do is they kind of sugarcoat their agenda of destroying the whole incentive plan of God by saying, well, yeah, Jesus is nice. He said some nice things. You can still listen to his nice things, but don't believe there's some that Jesus is really still alive and talking to you. And that's crazy, actually. That's psychotic, they say. No, it's actually psychotic to believe that Jesus cannot speak with us and that Jesus is dead. That's psychotic, because that's a sickness of the mind to believe such nonsense, that the mind is somehow can be disempowered in any way, because the natural power of the mind is perfect communication. So to say that we don't all still have perfect communication is very psychotic. So that's what's really going on. So there's this huge, subtle, insidious effort to undermine our faith. So I send the Dharma Kings to all of you. I tell the Dharma Kings, go in and introduce yourself to everyone. Everyone, please. You know, don't make a liar out of me, you know. I'm under enough pressure as it is. So I want miracles for everyone. Because it's a lot of pressure on me to speak up like this. It's just, you don't hear other people speaking up like this. And I understand the extreme importance of it. We cannot keep drifting. The way the spirituality is working out in the world, it's a dangerous trend, actually, because I noticed that hardly anybody is giving credit to the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, the Dharma Kings, their gurus, all this stuff. They're just saying, well, I can do it myself. That's a dangerous path to go down, because it's disincentivizing culture in a very big way. It's too difficult unless you have strong incentive, and if they just say, "Well, no, I don't need any incentive. I can just do it. My intellect is smart enough to do it." That's, you know, very, very bad, very non-dharmic, very much so. So I don't see hardly anyone. Someone says, well, I know that, I realize that, you know, this, you know, that something about this, something about like spaciousness, blah, whatever. And I think I got it. And they start talking about it, whatever. They don't say anything about the Dharma Kings. For me, I experienced intrinsic spaciousness because Longchenpa triggered that experience in me. His very presence is what caused it in me, that gave me the confidence somehow to experience it. So it was his doing, the Dharma King Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, is the one responsible. He has a co-responsibility, you might say, very strong, for my experiencing of intrinsic spaciousness. And Longchenpa doesn't stand alone. He had Padmasambhava and Manjushri, right? Which is, you then go back to, you know, the grace of God, the Holy Spirit. All of that is in play. All of it's in play for our success. My success does not take place in a vacuum. No one's success takes place in a vacuum. But 99% of the people in the world having spiritual success, they act as though it took place in a vacuum, like they did it themselves. So that helps collapse dharmic culture, and they're not really in abundance anyway. It's almost like sabotage, actually, in my opinion. You have to give the credit where credit is due. To be dharmic, you have to do that. To be a bodhisattva, you have to. Nobody, I mean, for me, everyone's helped me. Everyone, all of us, everyone had played some role in helping me. Okay. That's how I feel about it. And certainly the Dharma kings have had this massive, massive role. Without them, I could have done nothing, really. You know, they built the infrastructure. It's there, and so I'm driving down the road down to a pizza place, and gee, this is good pizza. Well, who built the roads and the car and the pizza place and everything else? And I'm eating good pizza. I really know what good pizza tastes like. Well, you know, there's a lot of stuff that went into me having that pizza, and it wasn't just me. So we have this very irreverent culture, which refuses to give acknowledgement where acknowledgement is due. And that disincentivizes everybody else and makes it much more difficult for them. They think, well, I just have to do it all on my own. I had, in Course in Miracles, I had Jesus helping me all along. In dreams. I said, wow, Jesus has my back here. That was tremendous incentive. Tremendous incentive. I couldn't have done it without him, actually. Not in the intense way that I did it. So everything that I've done, I've had Dharma King support in doing. Everything. And it's important to speak up about that because so we don't allow this cultural decay to take place. It's an insidious path we're on right now. They're helping everybody. Anyone that succeeds is getting the help from the grace of God for sure. For sure. So it'd be very helpful if everybody spoke up about that and says, you know, if I see somebody suffering, you know, in really low down life, and I say, there but by the grace of God go I, for sure. If I didn't get all this help from the grace of God, I would be, you know, on the lowest skid row, for sure. So, that's, you know, humility. We need to have humility and point out who has helped us. Not just, hey, I got enlightened, you know, everybody, I'm enlightened now or something. Wait a minute. First say, hey, wait a minute. Hey, everybody, look at all these wonderful, look at how much the grace of God, how effective the grace is God has been in such a, you know, an idiot such as myself. So without the grace of God, I'd just be like the worst idiot in the world. And that's the truth. That's the truth. And again, and give credit where credit's due. Religious people still do speak up a little bit that way. I mean, some Christians still speak up that way, and they say, "Hey, I'm a sinner. You know, without the grace of God, I'm lost. I am lost." And really, we are lost. Our habits are so severe that we just keep on repeating them. That's the problem with habits, isn't it? If you can't break habits, you just continue on with them. And the kind of habits we have are so severe, without the grace of God, could we really break those habits? That's why we have the Holy Spirit. God says, Spirit is trying to pretend and that fixation is possible, a freedom for and produce so much doubt about reality that the Spirit has got is overlearned this so much that it's so familiar. Because God knew we'd use our creativity to try and do this. So he said, well, obviously there's going to be familiarity problem there. For sure. So immediately creates the Holy Spirit, grace of God, to help us out with this problem. Otherwise, we might indeed be trapped by habit. And a lot of us are. We feel trapped by habit. So you can't just say culture, that's okay. Yeah. Don't worry about it. You got bad habits? We all got bad habits. You know, just have fun with your bad habits, you know. Find a way to have fun with them. That's okay. Your drug act, that's okay. You know, it's what you want to do. It's your life. Nobody has the right to tell you what to do with your life, so sure. No problem, you know, using heroin. That's okay. You know, they say, sure, assisted suicide. You know, you're having trouble. You know, sure, you can take whatever drugs you want to, you know, commit suicide. That's okay. You know, it's that kind of thing. That's what they end up doing. Without the grace of God, all you can do is say, you know what, these really super bad habits that are really causing me to continue to feel insecurity, hey, what else can we do? Nobody can do anything about it, so we might as well see if we can enjoy it. Light up a joint and try to enjoy it. And that's what they do. Here, have some beer, have some alcohol, let's have some giggles, and just try and try our best to just enjoy hell, basically, is what their advice boils down to. And, you know, if you're going to dance with the devil, you might as well do a fast dance. You know, might as well dance the heck out of it. And that's their belief. Don't do a slow dance. Just do a fast dance. So they're fast dancing with the devil. That's what they're doing. So we're still working in what I feel is fruitful way, and we'll see how this can go. I'm still getting a tremendous amount of miracles, tremendous number of miracles. And just noticing that the trending is very, very good here. Very great. I just notice it and say, hey, wow. Notice this, notice this, notice this. Some sort of animal is climbing around. I hear them. I don't know what it is. But some critters out there. Don't ever believe that anyone dies, actually, because they don't. They just imagine the death of the body to believe that they've somehow fixated the mind, or at least they're making progress towards it, right? But the spirit that's imagining, pretending to be this body, the spirit doesn't die. It's still pretending. The awareness is still there. It says, okay, what do I need to pretend next? Is what it'll do. Say, okay, I pretend that the body died, that this body that's dying, and now, okay, what do I need to pretend next? Oh, I need to pretend another body's dying. Okay, yeah, it's like that. It's dreaming, pretending. So nobody dies. Everyone's in eternal life, and the Dharma kings are eternal life too, except they're not pretending to, you know, to try and fix, trying to make progress towards changing the mind, fixating freedom. They're not involved with that. So their involvement is with the grace of God to incentivize us to right practice, and which we say here is to commit to one evaluation that sums up all evaluations, and that to use just that one evaluation for everything. As a practice, and therefore you just, all the other evaluations, you lose interest in them, you're not even paying attention anymore, and you lose interest. And I've found, as far as losing interest goes, it is absolutely doable. It's amazing what you can lose interest in. So I've gone through a lot of different practices now of losing interest in stuff that I used to be fanatically interested in. like sports, for instance. I was the sports guru, and I just knew everything. Now I don't have any interest in sports anymore. So if I can do that, it's literally, it's like anyone could lose interest in the whole world, really. And I pretty much have. And so I've tested all this stuff out, music, everything that I was so interested in, I've been able to drop interest in it. It's not easy. You just have to do it. There's ways to focus your mind. You have to have a lot of faith, and there's a lot involved to do it. But when you do it, now it's like I look back and I say, ah, I lost interest in movies. I haven't watched a movie, I don't know, maybe it's 30 years now. Just lost interest in it. That's it. And TV, radio, okay? I don't watch TV. I don't watch radio. I just lost interest. I have no interest in it anymore. Sports, all that stuff that people are so habituated to, I've proven you can lose interest in it. So there's no way anybody can tell me that they can't do it, because I know it's just a matter of you actually doing it. Just stop doing it. And you say, okay, I'm going to break this habit. And it's just a habit of familiarity and interest. And the longer you stay away from it, the less interest you have, to the point where you don't even think about it anymore. It's not even on your mind. It doesn't even come up in dreams or play through your mind hardly at all. It's gone. Your interest is gone. So once you have hindsight to see that the play of interest, you literally can do this. Then you know that you can break these habits. Nobody can say that they can't. It's a fact that anyone can break these habits. There's nothing really standing in the way except our decision to do so. Latest one, I was surfing. The Holy Spirit said, oh, yeah, that's enough. So I'm starting to, pull my attention away from surfing. I'm starting to form a new habit. And the Holy Spirit says, maybe that's not the best thing to do right now. And it's okay. And so stop watching the contest, stop paying attention to surfing, and the interest will dwindle. I'm sure it will, just like anything else. You might have a special relationship. You think that you'll can't live without them. And if they're not there, you'll die. But when you finally part ways, maybe you, as every day goes by, gradually, you find your attention on other stuff. And before ultimately, you forget about them. Yeah, I've been through that too, for sure. I think we all have. I went through it really bad, actually. Really, really bad. Never saw him again. Circumstances pulled us apart. It was, one of those things like, they make movies out of that kind of stuff. So I lived that, actually. And I thought I felt like I'd met my best friend in the world, but circumstances pulled us apart. And it was horrible for both of us. And just, wrecked me for, like, I don't know, 5 years or so. I just said, this isn't fair. Life isn't fair. This is horrible. And I just couldn't let it go. Because, hey, it's hard to find friends in this world, right? And if you've just find someone that just you feel like you can be yourself with, that's super rare. But I lost even that just through wretched circumstances. We didn't really want to part ways at all. Neither one of us did. And so, it breaks your heart. Terrible. But ultimately, you know, just you finally have to move on with your life. Your attention gets on other stuff, and you have to let it go. So yeah, stuff was constantly happening here, where you find everything you want seems to slip through your fingers. But even that habit, ultimately is the peace of God. We have to get the peace of God resting upon us in order to not go back to habits. Okay, so it's not like you can break habits without faith in the peace of God and without actually finally abiding in the peace of God. Because if you don't do that, you will go back to your bad habits. You will go back to really establishing new bad habits. For sure you will, 100% for sure. There's nowhere else to go but to do that. So really, to be free of suffering, one has to reach the peace of God, accept the peace of God. That which cannot be evaluated. One has to abide in that which cannot be evaluated. And it's not easy, because there's all sorts of mental currents that try to sweep us away from it. Takes tremendous patience, actually. And the culture, in a culture which is super impatient, this is really a bad culture. And I live in one of the most impatient places in the world, Silicon Valley. The driving here is just atrocious. Everyone you meet, all they want to talk about is how hideous drivers are and how hideous the people are. You know, it's the me culture here. And everybody is in this frantic hurry to promote, you know, how great they are and get paid, you know, Buko bucks for it. And it's just, you get, you know, dazed and confused by the aggressive, egoic-like attitudes here. So it's hard, it's difficult to be super, super patient here. But really, it requires really great patience. You know, I've been working on a problem of being swept out of abidance. I've been working on it for years and years now. Every day. Every day I think I just have to resolve it today. And the roots go deep. And it's still tugging at me a little bit. One day it will be resolved. But until then, I have no recourse but to be patient and keep working at it. So you want a patient culture, slow-paced, patient culture, super, super helpful. This modern culture we have is very, very harmful. And it's showing up in everybody. People just can't get it, so they're just living on memories of those who have got it. You know, throwing up quotes from the past. And they say, well, you know, maybe I can't get it, but at least somebody did. And I say, whoa, 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 whoa. They don't want you to be just throwing up their quotes. They want you to get it, the peace of God. That's their whole point, not just for you to throw up their quotes. But that's what's happening. So I don't, in the short term, I don't see a lot of people really in abidance in this world. I really don't see it. I see a lot of people getting glimpses of it. And I believe they are getting glimpses of it. And but they're going to end up probably feeling that's probably the best they can do under these cultural circumstances. I've had, you know, many glimpses, and still I'm not in abidance. And I say, wow, you know, it's really taken a long time here. So what do you do under those circumstances? Have to incentivize them somehow in the long term, right? So we need long-term incentivizing, not just short-term, long-term. Large-scale, long-term incentivizing. And so we'll see, how that works out. But as far as some big, huge spiritual revival where so many people are in Biden's, if that happens, I would be very surprised. I mean, I'd love for it to happen. But based on what hindsight, what I know and can see, the deep-rootedness of the resistance is such, and the culture is such that it's presents a formidable barrier, actually, very formidable barrier, and that's showing up in people's attitudes and actions. You just don't see the confidence of that, that we really w would indicate that we're really going to have success in it. It's pretty rare to see that. It's quite rare. So this has to be understood from a bodhisattva standpoint of, okay, so you're in abidance. Okay, so there's a lot of activity out there in the darkness out there. Something's moving around. If I had a flashlight, I don't, but I could, anyway, let them do whatever they want to do. When you're in abidance, you have to realize that others may be erratic about it and try to get you, and then rationalize the being erratic about it as, well, we're having a lot of fun. We're having fun and we're going to something bigger. We're having a lot of fun going to something bigger like that. It's a rationalization. And so you can't buy into that. You have to stick to where you're at and work on, look, say, well, we'll incentivize it anyway, just in case you might need it. He said, maybe you don't need it. Your attitude is you don't need it, but we're going to keep working on incentivization for you, for everyone. And just stick to that. And that will open up the door for you, this attitude towards abidance. It really will. So there you go. That's the big breakthrough of this video, is the advice to just you stick to the belief that incentivizing culture is the right path to take, and you just keep working on that. Just stick with that, work on it, believe in the Dharma Kings, and commit to them because they know how to do it, what needs to be done, they know, and you just follow that, and then I believe that will really clear away the remaining obstacles on the path to be committed to that. I will see how it goes with me, but I can see the wisdom of this. Better safe than sorry, so we'll keep on making sure that that's available for if it becomes necessary, because people will rationalize their failures very cleverly, very psychotically. Very psychotics are very clever in rationalizing why they do, why they their mind is functioning the way it functions. That's what being psychotic's all about. It's they're so cleverly, so clever in the defense of it. They're able to rationalize it to seemingly a brilliant degree. But it's never that brilliant. But it's enough to unnerve us, really. It's enough to unnerve us. So that really makes it difficult for us to be in abidance, because they will rationalize not being in abidance in the peace of God, as the right thing to do. And you just don't, you just don't see it the way they see it. They're having a lot of fun. So it's coming. It's coming to me. I'm having, really key insights. I can't remember exactly what they are, but I'm wowing them. It's okay. And wowing them helps them return an even more clear format. So this has been a very helpful video to help us understand the parameters that we're working under here a lot better. And really, that's even more helpful than these quotes. I mean, these quotes could be helpful, but it's bigger than that. You have to understand what the parameters are. What is it that's undermining you, your success, and how do you maintain your success? And all of this stuff is really important to recognize, that we're like fish in the ocean. I mean, the ocean temperature affects all fish in the ocean. So we have to realize that the way the culture is, it is affecting us. It really is. So I have to wow this video and not try to remember what I said. I know it's on track, so I just wow it and see, how it goes. So that's what I have to do. I just have to be patient. I have to be patient and wait for the next wave of clarity to come. It's like you're out in the ocean and there's waves. A wave comes and then you got to wait sometimes for the next one. I'm just sitting out there just waiting. You have to be patient. You have to be patient. Okay. Very great. I'm going to stop this one before I go on too long. And keep your faith. Keep your faith, keep your faith, keep your faith. And use wow practice. Commit for the wow is the one evaluation that sums up all evaluating. All evaluating. We have the answer. We have the progress. Okay? The progress is wow. And it's how much? It's wow much. Okay, so one evaluation, one answer for all our evaluating is we've got it. How do I evaluate my success? Wow. That's how I evaluate everything. That's my sole evaluation. This is wow, this is wow, this is wow, this is wow. Peace of God is wow. That's my evaluation of it. It's like, well, how good is the peace of God helping me to fixate reality? Wow. Okay. So how is this, again, I'm abiding the peace of God. Well, how is that helping me fixate reality? I know. I know, I've already evaluated it. And the answer is wow. My evaluation is wow. So I have, tremendous faith that this is working and will work and bring me the success that I want. So I will certainly keep doing it, and we'll help others along the way. Okay, that's it for this one.